I get that a lot. A lot of people are like, man, I wish you would sing more. I'm thinking in my head, I'm like, that's like all I'm doing. But yeah, I see what you're saying. A lot of people consider what I'm doing not singing. A lot of people have the conception that what I'm doing is called a cappella, which it is, but it's also singing, just with no words, imitating the video game sounds. But yeah, I'd like to do more stuff singing with words, maybe, you know, even more syllables. Like One Winged Angel, on the Latin stuff, you know. Even though I got a lot of people saying that I mispronounced the Latin words, but you know, I guess the proper pronunciation of the Latin words nowadays is what the modern Italians pronounce it as, like their version of Latin. But then I found out that their version of Latin is not how the actual Latin speakers back like 3,000 or 2,000 years ago spoke, so at least I have that in my defense. But yeah, I'd like to do more stuff like that. There are some songs that I've been listening to for a long time that I would like to cover that have words. I have thought about adding words to songs sometimes. That seems really inspiring. Even video game songs that don't have words that like mean a lot to me. It's like, man, I can just picture like a story going over it or something like that, like a main melody line with words. But I haven't delved too much into that, just kind of with ideas. But yeah, I would like to do more of that in the future. Black shirt.
Mr. McGroove, when are you going to stop teasing us and do Armored Armadillo?
Armored Armadillo, man. I've been wanting to do that one for a long time. I have that song fully arranged. It's like in my folder. I arranged it like a year and a half ago. But at that point, there were so many songs that I wanted to do and so many requests that it's hard to pick. It got hard to pick, you know? It got really hard to pick which songs to do week to week. So I have Armored Armadillo. It's definitely on the list. I love the entire Mega Man X soundtrack. Yeah, for sure. Axe. Ooh, that's hard. I didn't get to play enough games in 2014. Of course, Shovel Knight was really fun. What else did I play? Smash was a lot of fun. That's a blast. But I have to say, as far as like time played, Mario Kart 8 was really fun. But as some of you know, like I actually still enjoy Mario Kart 7 more. I don't, and that became a thing in my streams, which some of you know. But I really enjoy Mario Kart because it's a little more casual. It's competitive like Smash it can be, but it reminds me a lot of being like 8 years old, sitting in front of my TV, just like playing Mario Kart all Saturday. So, yeah, Mario Kart. Let's get someone a little further back. You with the hat.
You started out as a drummer, correct?
Yes. Well, I talked about this last year, but yeah, basically it was like I had a creative block. I was inspired like at the end of 2012, and I had written a few songs for a video game project, and it was really fun, and I had like a fire under me. I was like, I could do this, but the video game project kind of failed. It didn't do any, you know. It like we had the graphic artist, like he drew some sprites and. And then like the story guy and the systems guy, he had ideas, but the programmer just said, I don't have time. So I had these songs that I wrote, and I was like, oh man, I want to keep writing. And of course, like me being a drummer, I was like, well, you know, I can put down a beat, come up with a melody, come up with a bass line, you know, just write some stuff. But the hardest thing for me was to like come up with lyrics or come up with, or be even confident enough to like sing anything. Because I always sing along to music. I love doing that, like, you know, riding around in the car, you put on your favorite album or something and like harmonize with it. That was like where I got my practice, I guess, singing. But I think I slowly built up enough confidence to start singing more, to even like write lyrics. And for me, my release and the way that I kind of opened up was just coming at it with a mindset of, this is just going to be a lot of fun, and I don't care what comes out. So that's what I did. Like, I, and because of that, everything that came out was extremely goofy. It was just like the silliest lyrics, the silliest themes. But I didn't judge that. I just like let it happen. And I ended up coming up with some songs. And I think the first one that I actually like felt good enough to post was, what was it? I Don't Play Games When I Play Games. I did that song. And like there's a few other on my channel that I posted. There were some I posted on my Bandcamp and took down. But it was definitely a learning experience. And I was having so much fun just doing music for the sake of music. Even if, like, you know, like, I had confidence in drums. I knew I could lay down a drum beat to any style, but my bass playing is pretty rudimentary. Guitar playing is pretty good, but I'm not the best, like, technical guitar player. But I could definitely come up with melodies and harmonize over myself. That was something I was really comfortable with. In fact, like, my kind of inspiration in the beginning was like, well, I could put down a drum beat and, like, make all the melodies and stuff with my voice and then, like, imitate it with guitar and bass. And I actually did that with a lot of stuff early on. So, 1 week came around and I had done a song. I think it was like a Minecraft song. I had a lot of fun with that. And I, for this entire week, I kept coming up with like, trying to come up with melodies, coming up with song ideas. And it was just like this creative block. And for any of you that do anything creative, creative block is just a fancy term for like doubting yourself. Like you think everything that you're doing, you don't have confidence in. Any type of creative block is just based on like that simple fear of like, oh, what if it doesn't work out? What if this is bad? And then and you get in that mindset and it perpetuates itself and you end up just like stalling. So what I did was I remember one afternoon I came up with the idea. I was like, man, it'd be really fun to like cover a song with all vocals because I know I could do that. It would be different. It would be a lot of fun. And I did that with Zelda's Lullaby, which I was really familiar with. I just like laid down the tracks from memory, went back and listened to the song afterwards and fixed some stuff, and then, you know, in like less than 48 hours I had put out that first a cappella video. And it was different than what I'd been doing. It was, I definitely didn't have the full confidence in it, but it was just so much fun because it was so different and so unexpected even for like me. I never would have thought about that. But I got a really good reception from friends and family. They're like, dude, that's cool, man. Like even my like mom, who like didn't listen to video game music much, was like, she loved it. She's a vocalist, and from there I was just like, man, I could do this better. So I did like another one and another one and another one, and I just like kept doing it, and I realized, you know, like I could improve. So I hope that answers your question. Master Sword. Yes. I'm a huge Metroid fan, especially the early Metroid games. I love all of that music. It's got such an amazing feel to it, the music and the games themselves. So yeah, I want to do a lot of Metroid music. In fact, I have another Metroid song like mostly arranged. I think it's, I can't remember which one it's from, but it's from Super Metroid. That's like, I just need to like finish it. I have so many like half-finished little arrangements and stuff because I'll start one and then I'll be like, no, but I want to do this one instead. And then you know, I'll go read the comments on a video and someone will request a song that I didn't think of. I was like, oh, that's the one. So it's just like, you know, finally, you know, do a song. So yes, more Metroid. I will do more Metroid. Let's get over here. Yeah, you.
Okay, I have two questions if that's all right.
That's cool. Yes. Yeah, he, you know, even before I made my videos when he was really young, he was a cat, man. They want to do their thing, and if you make them do a thing that's not their thing, they don't want to do that thing. And so So when I first started making my videos, I quickly realized that if he was going to cooperate, especially like later on, because the first video was kind of natural, like he was in my lap already, because I trained him to be as chill as possible. But yeah, if I learned that if I fed him right before, he would just chill out. You know, because cat, if you have cats, so you probably realize that like if they're hungry, they're in that predatory mode, because cats are predators, man. They want to eat meat. They want to like kill a bird and like, you know, like eat the entire thing. So like they get in that mode. So yeah, if I feed my cat right before, he's extremely chill.
Is there
Sometimes it's creative block, but a lot of times it's the daunting feeling of like, how am I gonna do this? One Winged Angel was the first one that I remember pulling up and like starting to arrange and just thinking, whoa, dude, this is gonna be huge. This is so much, you know? And I ended up shelving that one for a long time, and I'm really glad I got back to it. But yeah, I have another song or two. One of them is fully arranged. It's been sitting in my folder for a while and had help with this arrangement. It was actually sent to me by Hiberno from The Stream. And he's a really good musician, and he arranged a song for me. I won't spoil it. But then I went over it, and then I had another friend go over it and refine it even further, because I was like, man, this is so technical. And we kind of made it like as perfect as possible. But I still look at that song individually, and I'm like, man, this is... I'm not even sure if I can pull this off. But the funny thing is, every time I say that, I know, like, I end up realizing that I can. It just, it requires doing some things that, like, I never thought I could, or recording methods, or more multi-tracking, things like that. Just, and I think that's one of my favorite things about this whole Smooth McGroove, like, a cappella project, is that every time I come upon, like, a problem with a song, as long as I, like, chill out and realize I could do this, it ends up happening. It just ends up being different than what I thought it would be. You know, either more multi-tracking or, like, just having to adapt chip sounds to a voice, you know. And it always ends up being fun. Sometimes it's a little different, but yeah, for sure. All right, more. Let's get someone from the back. Yeah, you in the back. Yes, you, pointing at yourself. That one took about a day and a half to fully arrange, because I did use the Castlevania 2 version. It was a lot simpler, and it was really easy to listen to. That was the thing, because I'd listened, you know, I'd heard the other versions with the guitar solos and stuff. And that's really fun, but for me, part of the fun is, like, taking an older song and seeing how, especially at that point. Like, I'd only been doing it for, like, I think 3 months, maybe even 2 months at that point. Yeah, I think I'd only been doing a cappella videos for 2 months, so I was still in the mode of, like, I wonder what this song will sound like, you know? So, like, early Castlevania tunes was, like, that was, like, totally on my radar. But with that song, I arranged it in about a day and a half, and I ended up building on it more, because I realized I could add an octave here, and, like, a harmony here, and, like, you know, I could do this and that, and it just kind of ended up being way more tracks than I originally anticipated. But that's what I wanted. Because I had done the original, like, Zelda song, the Zelda theme from Zelda, and I just did the original three tracks, and, it was accurate, but I didn't spend near as much time on it. I wasn't near as inspired, because I wasn't doing anything creative besides just doing the song. So with that Castlevania tune, I wanted to open up and, like, have fun with it. And I've noticed that the videos that I'm the most proud of are the ones that I end up having the most fun with. So, yeah, I had a lot of fun with Bloody Tears. Okay, you with the mask. I think it's an inside joke from The Streams. I think she does. That's all I have to say. You in the front with the red. Yes.
Do you ever plan on doing anything from the Suicide franchise?
Yes. In fact, I wasn't even familiar with that franchise before I started doing these songs. Those are some early requests, and I was like, I'd heard the name, but I'd never played any of the games, and I still haven't played any of the games. But I am familiar with at least three or four songs, and they're all really good. It's just I've been meaning to get around to playing at least one of them. And it's hard for me to do a song from a game I haven't played, because if I don't have that, like, emotional connection to the game, it feels like I want that connection. I want to play the game before I do the song. So yeah, hopefully someday. Sorry, what? Oh, yeah, that would definitely make it easier to get a hold of, for sure. A pink sign in the back. How's it going? Sorry, what? Will I drink out of it? Maybe afterwards. We'll save it for afterwards. But yeah, I'll acknowledge that request. How about a poster in the back? So you're asking, like, what aspect of songs in general is the hardest?
Yeah.
It's usually the lead vocal, honestly, because that's the most expressive, like Guile's theme, for instance. I mean, I could nail all those tracks, but if I wasn't feeling it with the lead track and I just kind of, like, sang it just, like, as a robot, and it's, you know, like, robotic and not no emotion, it wouldn't work, you know? It would still sound like the song and people would listen to it, but I think it's... that human expression, the fact that, like, the voice is the most flexible instrument, like, in existence, because we have a direct connection to it from our brains, you know, we don't have to go through anything. So for me, it's like, I listen to the song, and if it has a very strong lead melody, like Guile's theme, then I know that I'm gonna be doing a lot more takes, like a lot more takes. And I've struggled with that with songs down the line, because what I would do is I would get in these modes, or especially when I got on the weekly video thing, where I had a song and I'd you know, because I usually do the lead stuff, like, not first but not last. I usually do, like, the harmonies, any backing melodies first, and then I tackle the lead, and then I do the bass, and then I do the drums. That's usually the order I do it. So by the time I get to the lead, I'm warmed up. And I'm able to, like, you know, listen to the way the song is sounding and kind of see what it needs. Because on that same topic, I've had some people that really enjoy it when I kind of deviate from the way the original song sounds, like if I bend notes, if I add vibrato, all that stuff. And then I've had some very stickler people like, why do you bend that note? That's not in the song. Why do you, why you add vibrato to that? That's, you know, and so there's that, you know, like, there's the aspect of replicating the song exactly as much as possible and making it sound like the original NES chip or whatever, or making it sound as human as possible. And I'm torn between the two, because I love to just replicate the song with voice and see how it sounds, and, you know, be as straight with the notes, no vibrato, like I've done some songs like that, but it doesn't feel right. It feels like I'm turning into a robot. And, you know, I may as well just be, like, you know, playing my keyboard, you know, and doing a keyboard arrangement. But then, on the other end, where if I'm, like, overly expressive, sometimes, and not all the times, but sometimes I'm like, it didn't need that. It didn't need that bend. It didn't need that vibrato. It didn't need that that trill, or this thing that I threw in there, or this, you know, whatever. But more often than not, it works better if I err on the side of being more human. Like, I've noticed that the songs that people really like the most are the ones where I really just kind of let loose and allow, you know, intuition to take over. Like, I know the melody and I just sing it, like, I, you know, without even thinking, and that tends to work out the best. But yeah, that, because of that, that's why the lead is definitely the hardest of them all. And the bass track can be difficult to some songs, but that's kind of on a different thing, because the bass register, you know, it's not near as expressive. So, yeah. You in the front.
I was just wondering if you could actually, like, just describe a little bit about your process from, like, arranging to recording.
Yeah. So the process from arranging to recording, it's changed a lot since I started. When I first started, it was extremely organic. Like, I just knew a song, like Zelda's Lullaby. And I would just sing the parts. I'd bring up my recording software, which I record with Cubase, and I just would put on a metronome. You know, in the beginning, I didn't even, like, listen to the original song and get, like, a tempo. I just, like, put on the metronome and just, like, came up, was like, oh, 100 sounds good. And so I would just put on, like, you know, my metronome at 100 and, like, sing the parts to Zelda's Lullaby, like, or one part at a time. After a few songs, I realized, okay, that was a little too fast, or that was a little too slow, you know? And I wouldn't realize it until afterwards, because I would be totally absorbed in the process. I get very tunnel vision with this stuff. And I think that's the only way I'm able to do this, is like, if I wasn't able to get tunnel vision, and I did this, I would be daunted by the amount of work this stuff takes, you know? Like, even just music in general, anyone that does music in general, writing, covering, it's daunting if you want to do it right, especially recording everything yourself. So I eventually got to the point to where I would listen to the original, I would find the exact tempo, 118.75 beats per minute or something like that, and you'd be surprised on how many songs have these weird, tempos, because they're on they were on like the NES chip or the Sega chip, and it didn't run off beats per minute. It ran off something else. So find the tempo, and early on I would just sing the parts. But it got later on, especially with more complicated tunes like Bloody Tears, I would instead of just like singing rough tracks and then refining them, I would start to on my MIDI keyboard, I would just like basically play the notes and like drag them to where I needed them to be so I could listen to them, or I would bring up the original track and just like sing over that directly. And I think by the time I did Ewan Owen Was Her from Toho, like that was when I realized if I was gonna do a song that difficult, everything needed to be in front of me, like before I even started. So I think that was the first song I like super like arranged, like all in my program beforehand, where I had this like chiptune sounding arrangement before I even started. But yeah, once I get that, or once I have the arrangement, or once I've done the rough tracks, it's just refining. It's just singing over them, finding, you know, what feels the best. If I need to multi-track with even single tracks, like say if a bass line is too intense, I'll just do two bass lines and I'll intertwine the notes, and it makes it so much easier. And that kind of goes into his last question, where it's like, the more you multi-track a single track, the less human it sounds, but sometimes it's unavoidable because of these crazy arpeggios that are in some of these songs, or you know, crazy bass lines or whatever. So yeah, from there it's just work and just listening, trusting my ear and being like, okay, that sounds good. That doesn't sound good. Okay, redo it. Okay, that sounds better. I'll leave that for now. And I'll go to the next track and next track and next track. And then, you know, I'll have like four tracks down. And I'll listen to them all together and I'll realize that first track, okay, I need to redo it. Or at least I need to redo the second half or something like that. So that happens sometimes. But after that comes the mixing, which early on I did none of that. I would just record the tracks as they were, stack them together, and then output to a WAV file. And I soon realized that, you know, that's not the best thing to do. Like, sometimes the lead needs to be louder. Sometimes you need to turn the drum tracks down. Sometimes the bass track needs a boost in the bass frequencies for it to even come out. That was a big thing. I think with Guile's Theme was one of them, where when that song became popular after I did it, there were some like recording engineers that would actually contact me and be like, "Hey man, see, what you need to do is you need to redo your bass track and up your frequencies in the 75 hertz range, and then like do a gate and then do this and that," and all this like technical jargon that I had no idea what it meant. And that's when I realized I need to start like paying more attention to the frequency range, because you know, sometimes my bass vocals, even though I can get really low, like it gets really quiet, so I needed to boost that. Sometimes the drums would be too loud. Anyways, yeah, so that's the process. You in the back with the blue water bottle, yeah. Yeah, I mean, I'm super open to collaborations. The only issue is that, like, I've always been a loner, I guess. The guy in my room by myself doing my thing. And as much as I enjoy collaborating, sometimes it, for lack of a better word, feels wrong at the time. I don't know how to put it. And I haven't had I've had a lot of like collaboration requests, but it's hard to put it into words. There is a YouTuber out there who has wanted to collab with me from the beginning. He's a great singer, does great stuff, and he is like the antithesis of me. All he does is collaborate. every video is a collaboration. And it's like, I can tell, like, by watching him and talking to him, he's a nice guy, and he gets energy from that. It energizes him, you know, pulling in this violinist and doing a song, pulling in this vocalist and doing a song, getting this a cappella group and doing a song with them. It's like, he loves it. And for me, it's like the opposite. It's like, the idea of a collaboration can be really fun, but especially if it has to do with my own channel, like where I post my videos, it starts to feel really weird. I don't know what it is. And I realize that's just me, you know? And I'm still not opposed to doing collaborations, but it's almost like I would love to do collaborations with other people's projects so that it's not like me, like, putting all this energy in and, like, matching this energy with this other musician and, like, we're putting this thing out on my channel and, like, it being judged by everyone, you know? It's like, I would almost rather it be something else. Like, something completely unconnected, something fun. Because I think that's what it comes down for me. It has to be fun. And, I've recently started playing drums more. You know, I got away from drums, and, like, it's such a fun thing. I mean, you guys haven't seen me play drums, and, like, no one's... But, like, I still love doing that. Like, I'll turn on... Like, last week, I turned on the Chrono Trigger soundtrack, and I was just playing drums along with it. It was awesome. I had a lot of fun. And even though, like, that's not visible, and I didn't record it and post it... you know, and I'm glad I didn't because I'm extremely rusty and all that stuff. And, you know, it takes a lot of practice. But, like, that stuff's fun for me. So, like, stuff that's unconnected to what I normally do. So doing, in like, an a cappella collaboration with someone, I don't know what it is. It just feels strange to me. It feels like weird territory. I don't know. And it's not like I'm so proud of myself. I just want to do it by myself. It's not that at all. It's like something about it feels like not as fun. I don't know why. But I hope that answers your question. I hope it wasn't too negative. You right here.
I have a couple questions. One, do you remember me from the stream?
From the stream?
Those were definitely a world of water mountain on my head.
Was that the night that I put a watermelon on my head? Yeah, okay. I may remember you. I got a lot of pictures of people that came with me in solidarity and put a watermelon on their head, actually. So, yeah. Oh, yeah. That's an awesome song. Telltale Heights is awesome. I listened to that the other day, actually. So, yeah, that's another one on the long list of songs to do. Backpack. You with the backpack. Yes.
Do you consider yourself in any voice part? And also, could you demonstrate your range?
So, the first thing, voice part?
Bass, baritone, tenor.
I know nothing about that. I was, I was in choir, like, for a semester in sixth grade, and I just remember it being really awkward and not very fun, kind of. So that's my extent of vocal training, really, besides, you know, like, just on my own. And demonstrating my range, well, you hear, this is how I speak, so this is, I don't know, maybe you can figure out my range from this, but the biggest thing that I think a lot of people don't explore with vocals, especially guys, is falsetto. And most of my singing is in falsetto, which is just the girl voice. Like, if you're a guy and you do the girl voice, that's falsetto. Because it's, like, way above where you normally speak. And girls can get really high with falsetto. I think falsetto, and I may be mistaken, but I think most dudes, even with really low voices, can get extremely high falsetto if they just try. I just don't think many people even know about it or try it. I may be mistaken. Maybe every one of you does this, but, like, when I would, like, sing along with music, like, in my car, whatever, I'd be like, I'd have, like, a Beatles album on or something, and I would sing, you know, like, Paul McCartney's part, you know, for whatever, or John Lennon's part, but then I would experiment and go higher, and then I would sing an octave higher, and then I would just experiment just goofily, you know, because you're in your car, no one else is listening. Just sing as high as you can along with the melody. So you're, like, two octaves above, and that's falsetto, and I don't know, like, I think, like I said, I think most dudes can get really high like that. I just think it takes practice to get control, it takes confidence. So, like, are you a vocalist?
I've been in a couple of acapella groups, so I'm a bassist, and it's just awesome to hear other guys that are really interested.
Yeah, cool. Yeah, I've had a lot of people, you know, send me messages and stuff that are actual vocalists, and they use terms like that, and I always feel like, man, I don't know anything about this. If you're talking to me about drums, I could tell you all this stuff. I could write out drum music for you, but like I was educated in drums, and I was never educated really in anything. I was educated in piano. Like, I took a year of piano lessons when I was younger, so I'm familiar with notes, familiar with the ranges and stuff. But outside of that, like, music theory is something that I understand, like, whenever people talk to me about it, but I don't know the terms. I've never been a big term guy. When it gets into terminology, and I think that's like the thing, like tenor, soprano, blah, blah, blah. It's like, for me, like, especially if I don't already know anything about it, it feels like this weird compartmentalization thing that, like, people have set these rules, and this is what this is, and this is what this is. And it's like, for someone who has any interest in a subject like singing or music or whatever, I think it's to open up your creativity, not to be good at it necessarily, but to open up your creativity. Like, not knowing anything about it is probably the best. But as a former music teacher, you do need structure. You do need to understand a lot of the terms. You do need to understand a lot of the technical aspects of whatever you're doing. But luckily with singing, I think singing is just like a natural instrument that everyone has to some capacity. You can fudge a little bit. You can be like me and like not know any of the terms and still get by. So hopefully that answers your question. You right there in the beanie. Biggest musical influences as far as vocals and drums. Man. Well, I'll go with drums first. When I was a kid, I loved like the Southern California punk music that was coming out because it was so fast and exciting, and it was different than anything I'd ever heard. Like, no one was doing that besides like maybe some speed metal bands from the 80s. But most of that stuff was really badly recorded, and it had a really raunchy feel to it. So when I was younger, I used to listen to a lot of these bands like, man, I could just name tons of them. Pretty much any band from Southern California that was making like really good, that had a really good drummer. As far as vocals, I don't know. I get really excited when I hear vocalists that are doing things that I never would expect. I think that's really inspiring to me because I'll say this. The least inspired I get when I listen to vocals is stuff like opera, stuff like, I don't know how else to put it, but like Broadway music. And I'll explain, because when I hear that stuff, it sounds so preconceived and structured and like this is what they do and they do it the same every time. And, you know, I don't understand opera or Broadway. I've never done any of that, so, but when I hear dudes or girls like doing really weird stuff with vocals, it gets me excited. In fact, I just had like an epiphany. Like in, I think it was 2011, I picked up an album by a girl who did all vocal music, and like the entire album was all vocals, and I can't remember her name, but it was so strange. This girl would, I think this is what she did, because I remember looking up a video. I think she had like a loop station or something, and she had a microphone plugged into it, and it's this little thing, and she was doing a live performance when I looked it up, and she would just like record this part, and then, you know, hit the loop, and record another part and hit the loop, but it wasn't what you'd expect. It was like stuff she was making up. It sounded like she was making it up on the spot. It was like some really cool melody, and then like another melody that just kind of like floated over it, and then like this really crazy like syncopated thing over that, and then She never even did like percussion parts, because what she was doing was percussive by itself, kind of, or sometimes not. And I remember after hearing that album, even though like she wasn't a professional vocalist or anything like that, she was obviously just kind of doing whatever she wanted to do. But because it was like that, it was like extremely inspiring to me, because it was coming from a place of like just pure creativity, no preconceived notions. You know, it didn't sound like she had any vocal training ever, but what was coming out was unlike anything I'd ever heard, because it was so outside of that box. It was like the opposite of like you know, what you'd expect an opera singer to do. Like, you know, obviously opera singers are amazing, and they're like, they can project and they have this technique that I can't do. You know, I think that's amazing. But I'm just saying, for me, it's like from where I come from, and I think what spawned my idea to do acapella video game music in general is just a place of like pure creativity with no preconceived notions. So yeah, hope that answers your question. Let's do you right there, holding your arm. Yes. Ace Combat stuff. I'm familiar with that, but I haven't listened to too much of it.
The Zero, at least.
Maybe. I need to be more familiar with it first before I say anything. Second question, hug, yes. First question, beard. Don't shave. Just don't shave and see what happens. That's all I can really say. You with the golden 3DS. Now, what did you first say something is doing really well? Oh yeah. That was with Patreon. Basically, at first, I was scared because I knew that like Patreon was going to be a way for me to make a living doing what I was doing. And then I realized that like, oh, there are people out there willing to donate a dollar when I do a video. That's so, oh man, yeah. It made me pumped. Like, I'm going to do more. I'm going to do better. And it hit a point to where I was like, oh my gosh, there's so many people like supporting me. And then it went from like, it went almost back to fear because I was like, oh my gosh, what if I don't do good enough? That question is like, what if I don't do good enough to deserve this? The word deserve comes in the back of my mind. And that's a bad place to be. It's like when you start thinking about that like deserving aspect. And So that's one of the reasons that it wasn't just Patreon, but it was everything that I stopped making videos for a while. It was because of everything got so big and crazy. Like, it felt like at that point where I realized that I needed to take a break. Like, I was answering so many business emails. I was thinking about that. I was thinking about the Patreon rewards. I was thinking about the licensing for the music, and I was thinking about all this stuff, and the last thing I was thinking about was making music and having fun, and it was just this big ball of like frustration, and I didn't really know how to deal with it. So that Patreon was part of it, but what I learned from like stepping back was that I learned how like grateful I actually was for everything. Like, I'm extremely grateful that like anyone was willing to subscribe to my YouTube channel and like leave a comment under and be like, dude, thank you, or something like that, or buy a song on iTunes because they liked it that much, or buy a T-shirt or donate a dollar or $2 via Patreon every time I do a video. Like, I realized how grateful I was for that, and it took me stepping back to like get out of that forest, because I was so in that forest, I was such in that drive forward mindset, weekly videos, motivation, all this stuff, like very left brained, and I kind of got away from my right brain, which was where it all came from in the first place. So I can safely say that now I feel a lot better. I have a much better perspective on that stuff, but it did take me stepping back and realizing that I do everything myself, and it can be very overwhelming. And I needed to do was learn when to step back, and just like take a deep breath and have fun again. So hopefully, yeah, answered your question and some other stuff too. Red sweater in the back, yeah. Yeah, recently I've been thinking a lot about that because, early on I was just kind of experimenting. I was doing whatever. Of course, video game was like video game music was the first stuff I did. And I branched out and did a few band songs because I was like, I wonder how this would sound. And did that parody, I wonder how this would sound. But yeah, recently I've been thinking a lot more about other stuff that I enjoy. Like, if you follow me on Twitter, you probably heard me recently gushing about like Hunter x Hunter. Like I watched the entire series, and you know, because I read the manga years ago, but it like stopped. Like the guy got sick, and I was like, no. So I watched the whole thing, and like after watching all 148 episodes of that, I was like, dude, that's awesome. And like the theme songs are great, and like it's so different than video game music. And you know, watching like I watched, you know, all of you know, Full Metal Alchemist Brotherhood. That's got a really good opening song. Like, and you know, listening, like watching movies, like any movie I can think of that I really enjoy. Like, they have great soundtracks and great theme songs, and even TV shows and cartoons that I grew up with have really great theme songs and stuff. So I've been thinking more about that recently, about like what people would think if I did something that wasn't from a video game. But I think that, oh, well, thank you. I appreciate that. That makes me feel a lot better about considering that, because it's video game stuff. It's so, you know, I've been doing it for a long time, and I still really enjoy it. But yeah, there's other things that I would like to do. And I think that was part of me taking a break as well, like, you know, setting up my drum set again, you know, making a room where, you know, I could, like, you know, wall it off to where my neighbors wouldn't be so mad if I played drums at, like, you know, 12 midnight. I have, you know, like, I got a new MIDI controller keyboard, so I can, like, play piano more and stuff like that. I've got my guitar restrung and retuned, which I neglected for, like, you know, a year and a half. Still haven't got my bass back from that guy, though. He still has it. But anyways, like, just, you know, branching off and doing other stuff, you know, not even just, like, music from other outlets, like, you know, movies or TV shows or whatever, but also, like, doing stuff with other instruments. I think that's a big part of it. But it's gotten to the point to where I'm so confident in doing all a cappella stuff now. Like, I just know that I can. And it's a good feeling to be that confident in something, you know, to have done it for so long and put so much work into it, to know that, like, yeah, I could turn that into an a cappella song. Yeah, you know, I don't think most people could do that, but I could do that, you know? Like, it's a good feeling, it's empowering. Even if it does turn out weird, like, you'd be surprised how many people would approach me and be like, yeah, I've seen your stuff, man. You know, and they're like, you could definitely tell it's not like their favorite thing, and it's kind of like a novelty. But I almost like that. I almost like the challenge of, like, you know, doing something that would seem like a novelty, but doing it to the best of my ability. So whether it's video games or, you know, songs from bands or other artists or music from movies. So, yeah. You, yeah. I haven't played the game. I watched part of a playthrough because I was interested in what everyone was talking about. And I don't remember the music too much. I just remember the feeling I got by watching the game and thinking, wow, this is not like most games that I play. But it was very good. It's very entertaining. There's a lot of new games like that I hear music from. And I'm like, man, that's different. That would be fun to try. So yeah, I'm not opposed to doing songs from that game or any new games. You, all the way over there, yeah.
Is there any song that you had a very, very hard time assembling together that you just got so frustrated with, you had to put aside
the best for the finger? Yes, yeah, the question was, have I ever worked with any songs that just frustrated me like crazy and put them away? Yes, like, I mentioned One Winged Angel earlier, and I think that wasn't because I was so frustrated, I was just, you know, daunted. But as far as being frustrated, another song I mentioned earlier, which is, every time I bring up that arrangement, I just think, man, this is crazy. It's awesome, but it's crazy. And I brought that up like three or four times. I'll bring up the whole project, and I'll get stuff organized, and I just sit down, and I'm like, wow, dude, I don't even know where to start. And that's only happened a few times because I generally work kind of like, I guess you could say this, it's kind of like if you take a really crappy math problem that you don't like, right? That's just extremely hard, but you have like some genius sit there and like simplify it for you. And you realize that it's like actually like 10 different problems that are really small and easy, but you just have to do them in order and like to get to the end. And that's how these a cappella things are. It's like you just simplify it as much as possible. But there are songs out there that have, you know, an arpeggio track or a main track or something that's just, there's like no way around it. It's just maddening It was never, ever written for with vocals in mind. So for a guy, you know, trying to do vocals to it, it's it could be a bit, you know, daunting and frustrating. But it's only happened a few times, but it definitely has happened. And you, yeah, all the way up. Yeah, I was actually asked about that yesterday, the Minecraft Hardcore series with PBG. That was a lot of fun. I was extremely glad that he invited me, because I'd watched one of the series before, and I was like, dude, that's pretty awesome. The Diablo 2 one, that's like my game. But the Minecraft one was really fun, and it ended so awkwardly. I won't spoil it for you if you haven't seen it, but I would definitely do something like that again if he invited me. You on the row here, yeah, black jacket.
Is there a series that you've gotten a lot of requests for that just leaves you cold and you've
got no interest in? Yes. And it happens for several different reasons. Sometimes it's because I haven't played the game or series, and it's hard for me to like feel a connection to any of the music. So what I normally do is bring up the music and I listen to it, and if the music's good, then it makes me want to play the game. And so I'm less cold on it. I'm a little more hot toward that. And then it's happened before where I've just like ended up playing the game or playing most of the game. I admit sometimes like I'll play a part of a game and be so excited that I don't even finish it and I just do the song. It's happened a few times. But recently, I guess it's a side, but like I just beat Xenoblade Chronicles. And that, yeah, like if you've played that game, it starts off really slow, but I was really familiar with the music from that game from like 3 years ago, and I had a friend who beat it, and the first thing he did was show me the music, and I was like, dude, this is amazing. Like, it's just, the scale is huge. And I started playing that game back then, and I got a little more hot on it because of the music, and I stepped away from the game for a long time, and I came back to it recently and just beat it right before I got here, actually, like the night before I got on the plane. And that made me extremely, like, I love that game. I love all the music from that game. But there are game series that I still haven't gotten to, that I still have never played. And there are some series that I have played that I just don't have much interest in the music because I just don't care about the game as much. I think it's usually, it doesn't happen often because most video games have really good music. But it's happened a few times where I just don't. I think it has to be the combination of I don't really care about the game as much as I do other games, and I don't care about the music as much as other games. It has to be that, because if it's got both of those things going for it, then I just won't really consider it near as often. But it doesn't happen often. It doesn't happen that often. In the back, purple hat or purple whatever that is. I am 30 years old. What cat food do I feed Charles? I've experimented with a lot of different stuff. I used to just feed him like the stuff from the grocery store, you know, like the hard food from the grocery store when he was young. But I noticed like he would gain weight easily, even though I wasn't feeding him that much. And I was like, that's probably not a good sign. Then I experimented with feeding him frozen chicken, like made for cats, and he loved it. Like, he could not get enough of it. It's like, you know, if you know anything about cats and their biology, they are meat predators. They eat like 92% of their diet is ideally just straight protein, and the other 8% is like mixed carbs and fats, so like meat. But because I had changed his diet so abruptly and I didn't ease him into it, Charles got sick, and he got really sick. And this was about a year and a half ago. And it made me really sad because I was like, man, I'm feeding him like the food that he loves and he can't eat enough of it. But like he started getting really lethargic and he started eating less and he just started acting not good. I've never seen him get sick before. Like he's always a really energetic cat usually. I mean, he's gotten like a cold here or there, but and then I realized that you're not supposed to change a cat's diet like that. You're supposed to wait, you're supposed to ease them into it, because cats' digestive systems aren't like dogs' digestive systems. Dogs are like the garbage disposal. You can give them any like human food and they're just happy and they're healthy usually. And you know, they do well. But cats, yeah, have a very delicate digestive system, even though they're, you know, they're meat predators, and maybe it's because of that. It's a very specialized digestive system. So he went through a point where he didn't eat for like 4 or 5 days, like almost at all. And I was like, dude, this is terrible. And then I'd realized by that point that I'd done the wrong thing by changing his diet so quickly. So since then, I've eased him back on. I buy them this like bag of like, it's all organic and grain-free food, which is great for cats because they don't need to be eating grains. And he loves the stuff because it's mostly like, you know, dried chicken and beef or something like that. And it's good for him. He's a lot more healthy. And it's weird because the like frozen chicken, he still hates it. It's weird, like it. He loved it, you know, before he got sick. But now it's like if you've ever eaten a food and then gotten sick and like thrown up, it's like I've met a lot of people where they'll never eat that food again. Especially if it was like when they're a child, when they're very emotionally susceptible to this stuff. And so Charles, like whenever I open frozen any type of chicken, he's not interested. But he loves it when I open up like a package of beef or like even bacon. Like he just smells the meat and really gets into it. But I think I scarred him where he won't eat chicken anymore. So, yeah, he eats organic cat food now. You, right here. My favorite song I did in 2014? Chrono Trigger, opening thing. Yeah. Yeah, that song was just, it was so near and dear to me, and I knew it wouldn't, you know, I knew it wasn't going to be like the Tetris theme where it would just get so many views and all these people would see. I knew it'd be like, I do this song and the people who have played Chrono Trigger, I want to do it as good as I can. And so they'll get pumped, you know, like I put a lot into that song and I planned for that song. In fact, I put that song off intentionally until I got my new microphone. Cause I was like, I don't want to do that song until I have like an optimized setup. Cause I'm going to regret it. And I think that was one of the first songs I did after I got my new microphone. And I'm glad because my new microphone has a much better bass response and I don't have to do near as much EQing, which is technical talk, but some of you know what I'm talking about. Are you holding up a banana?
Yes.
Okay, yes. Ever recorded? Man, that's hard. Because the situations, like the mental situation I'm in when I record a song plays a big part in that. When I recorded Spark Mandrill for Mega Man X, like I was in such a free creative place, and I had like no pressure on me from like anywhere. I felt at that point because my channel was still so small, and I was getting requests, you know, on my videos, and I would look at every single one of them like every day because I could do that, you know, there weren't that many, and. Spark Mandrill was a request, and it was a challenging request because I hadn't done a song like that with a big, strong lead and really cool, like, you know, fifth harmonies or whatever, and it had like a rock feel, and I was kind of scared. But when I started recording that, I realized that I could do it, and I realized that this was really fun, and it was just like, oh, it was just like this perfect storm, and I remember like how good I felt at the time, and like after I'd finished recording the song, my brother-in-law came over, and he was sitting on the couch. And I was playing through the mix. It wasn't like the finalized mix, but I played through it. And he was like, play that again. And this is a guy who never played Mega Man, any Mega Man game. And he like liked it. And it was such a good feeling. It was like, oh, it's just good music. And it's an opportunity for me to like expose people to music that they would have never otherwise heard through a way that they would be willing to listen to because it's a little more human. And yeah, so. Maybe, you know, Spark Mandrill. There are several like that, but that's one that really sits close to my heart. So, yeah. The Hylian Shield. Keyboard or pitch? Oh, yes. Yes, absolutely. That's the main thing. I need a reference point. Because if I have a reference point when I start to record a track, and it usually only has to be like the first track that I record, because I want it to be like, you know, everything on the same key, you know, no wavering. So what I'll do is I'll have my keyboard out and I'll hit like the first note, which will be like, you know, like a C or something. And I'll have that in my ear, and from then on, it's all good. I've made the mistake several times by just trying to record early on. I think it was my second video where I did like the Ocarina of Time intro. I recorded that, and I listened back, and I'm like, I didn't use a reference for that. I was just kind of doing it, and I wasn't really paying too much attention to the end product. I was just kind of doing the tracks at a time, and it's a little pitchy. And it's like, man. So I want everything to be good. I don't want to ever listen to a song and go, I could have done that better, like a lot better. Now, I don't mind listening to a song going, you know, like a few months later and go, oh, I could have done that. That would have been cool. But I don't like the feeling of listening to something and going, oh man, I want to redo that. You know, like that's the line that I don't want to cross. So, scarf. Yeah, Dancing Mad is another huge request. It was like that one and One Winged Angel were the two massive songs that everyone was like, you need to do this. You know, it is either you need to do One Winged Angel, you need to do Dancing Mad. You know, it's one of those two. So Dancing Mad is still definitely on my radar. It's just another one of those huge songs. It's basically like doing four songs. Pretty much like doing four songs and stitching them together because of those four movements. So when I'm in the mood for a massive project, and I'm feeling Final Fantasy VI again, which I got halfway through it last year, my second playthrough, getting halfway through a JRPG is not a good feeling, and then like stepping away, it feels like you left this gorgeous story unfinished, even though I beat it before. So yeah, maybe next time I come back to FF6, I'll feel Dancing Mad again, or maybe Terra's theme, or maybe all of them. They're so good. All of them are so good. We have time for a few more. You waving in the back. Yes, you waving. Yes. I plan on doing more Ace Attorney stuff ever since I did the first one. It's just, I try to keep myself from getting tunnel vision. Because I have the issue where when I do a song from a game that I really enjoyed the game or really enjoyed the music, I want to keep doing songs from that game in just like a straight line because it's like, yes. But I've intentionally, you know, scattershotted. I've intentionally done that because it keeps it more interesting for me. I think it keeps it more interesting for people who watch my videos every week because they don't know what's coming out, and that's my favorite part. So I've intentionally strayed from that. But yes, Ace Attorney, more in the future. Right there, N64 controller.
So I have two questions.
That's fine, yeah. Yes. The new Xenoblade. I especially after playing Xenoblade Chronicles, I just want that to come out like now. Like that's I'm like tunnel vision on that. Like I want that. I was talking to people about it last night. Pink. Kiku, yeah, you. That's fine. First question, rage song. I try not to get mad too much, but I can, maybe like Genova theme, the Genova theme probably. And what was the second question?
You've been in a battle for 3 years, Jimmy's or Sprinkles?
Jimmy's or Sprinkles? Yeah. I'm unfamiliar with what even that.
On top of the ice cream, you've got rainbow color.
Now, what are Jimmy's? Okay, wait. Oh, okay, their names. Yeah, okay, I'm not even familiar with Jimmy, so Sprinkles. Sorry. All right. You on the row, yeah.
I like to listen to your music a lot, but I'm working on the main thing. If you ever go back and just listen to
your
music actually,
or is that different? Yes, actually. I do that when I'm feeling down about what I'm doing, like when I'm feeling not so good. About like a project, because going back and watching those videos or listening to the music, it re-inspires me and makes me realize that like I can do this. It's going to turn out good. And oh, I did that. That was pretty fun. You know, like so. Yeah, I've done that several times. One more question. You right here, second row.
Yeah.
Yes.
This is kind of a special question, but I was thinking, you kind of making
physical CDs? Physical CDs. I've thought about it for a long time, but that kind of goes with an earlier question about like the business aspect. The more I like inch toward like the merchandising stuff, the less I think about music. So I just haven't. Like so many people have, you know, enjoyed me putting my music up on Louder and iTunes. And, you know, it's just, I haven't had enough people like demanding physical stuff that I've put enough energy into like going in that route. Because I know it's like a big route. I have to find a distributor and printer and stuff on it. So let's take one more question. One more. Yeah, Metroid. My favorite thing about owning a cat, they are the cleanest pets ever. Like, I'm just in awe at how clean he keeps himself at all times. Like, every time I look at him, I'm like, you're so shiny. You pick him up, you smell so good. What is this? You put a box in the corner with some, like, stuff in it, and he just does this. And you take that out, like, you know, once every few weeks. And that's my favorite part, besides the fact that, like, they chase everything. Any light, you know, it's manifested and real. He has to get it. So, but yeah, I think that's all the time we have for this. I think I'm doing an autograph session afterwards. So, I'm not sure where that is. Okay. Oh, wow. Well, yeah. Thanks for coming.